In the first part of the video, I will explain how you can detect outliers. And in the second part, I will show you what the effect can be of outliers on your statistical model if you do not remove them from your dataset. So I did the same as in the previous video. I created a script that I called rscriptoutliers. I saved it, and in the same location, I also save all my data, so I can say to R that my working directory is equal to the source file location. All right. Let's first again use simulated data to play a bit with different ways to detect outliers. So I make a variable, I call it X, and I store random variables in the dataset. So for example, I take 500 normally distributed variables. What can I do to visualize how these variables are distributed? I can make, for example, a histogram. So I take a histogram. So this 50 here controls your bin size. If you increase that, you get more bins. For example, if I put it equal to 100, you see you get a finer grid over your X values. If you make it smaller, for example 10, you get a larger grid. Right, so you have to choose a value that gives you a good result. I take 50 here. All right, and then you see that there is nothing abnormal in this data. Right, you have a mean of 0, and then you have values that are distributed around. That means some are smaller than 0, some are larger than 0. However, let's now add to my dataset an outlier. So my X is now a vector with 500 normal values as before, but I add the value 6. As you know, we have a normal distributed random variable. So you see that the values are around 0 and most of the values are between minus 2 and 2. There are a few that are larger or smaller than minus 2, larger than 2. But 6 is, if you look at this histogram, is really big, right? So it could be that the 6 is wrong, that someone had to enter 0.6 but accidentally added 6, right? And then you get an outlier. So if I now make the same histogram, right? Now you see this is all the data, but then you have here one value that clearly looks very different from all the rest, right? You see this is way much bigger than all the rest. It's probably an outlier. Of course, you have to be careful with outliers. Outliers can mean it's the wrong value. As I gave the example before, it should be 0.6, but someone accidentally put 6. But it could also be a real observation, just a very extreme situation that resulted in a very extreme value. Could also be. But the histogram shows you that this is probably an outlier. Another way to detect outliers is by making a box plot. In the box plot, you see the line here is the mean. Then you have the box where you have most of the values. And then you say here, well, most of the values are in the box, and then they can also be in this region above or below the box. But you see that this value here, that's our 6, is far, far away from all the rest. Again, that indicates that we have an outlier. So we have histograms, we have outliers that can be used to detect visually an outlier. In a histogram, it's an observation that is far away from the rest of the histogram. In a box plot, is an observation that's far away from the box of your box plot. All right, so we will come back on outliers later on, where we have a more quantitative way of detecting an outlier, of defining what is an outlier. But you can use a box plot and a histogram to visually find your outliers. All right, let's now use the dataset that is the dataset outlier.txt and apply what we have learned so far, histograms, box plots, to detect outliers in that dataset. As you can see, this is my data set. You have here header is false, which means that the first line in the data set is an observation. These are not the column names. And then, because there are no headers, R will call the first variable v1 and the second variable v2 by default. So let's store v1 in x and v2 in y. All right, so x and y, that is our data. And now I'm going to make a histogram and a box plot of both x and y to see if we have outliers. So we have here our plot commands, but I'm going to add a title to make sure that we can understand which figure gives which variable. And here are the results. So we have a histogram for x, histogram for y, box plot for x, box plot for y. But if we have a look at these plots, we cannot find really an outlier. Everything looks relatively okay. There are no extreme observations in the x or the y direction. However, note that here we look for outliers in the x variable by only looking at x. Right, so how do we detect outliers in x? It's with the histogram, this one, or the box plot. And when we construct the histogram and the box plot, we only use x, we don't use y at all. And the same can be said for the histogram of y and the box plot of y. So we are only looking at x, see if there is an outlier. Then we are only looking at y, see if there is an outlier. However, let's have a look at how does the data look if you plot x and y at the same time. So here is the result. Here you have the data, and then you see that there is this observation here, which is also an abnormal observation, right? Probably it's a wrong observation, but not because it's extremely large or small in x or y, but because it really, really deviates from the trend that you see in all the other observations. So in box plot of an outlier can detect really large or small values in x or y, but such value that is not extreme in the x or the y direction, but just deviates from the data, the rest of the data, in order to detect that type of outlier, you need what we call a scatter plot, right? A plot where you have x on one axis and y on the other axis. Let us now have a look what the effect is of outliers on a final model. So we will use a very simple data set with outliers and then fit a linear model on the data with and with outliers to see the difference. Of course, you can do a similar exercise if you want to use more complex models, but with the very simple linear models, you can understand the behavior and the importance of outliers already. Let me start with this data set with x and y values. This is just part of the data set, but I can already show the data. We have these observations here, and the linear model wants to draw a line through all these points such that each point is as close as possible to this line. Right? And in order to draw a line, we can use the LM function, so linear model function. If I do LM y1 x1, then R knows it has to search for that perfect line. And what you find is that R says, well, the line that fits these observations the best is the line where y1 is equal to 1.8961 plus 0.61 times x1. And for example, I can plot this line. I can do AB line. And AB line plots a line A plus BX, where A is equal to, in our case, should be equal to this value. And B, the slope, should be equal to this value, right? So now AB line plots the line 1.8961 plus 0.61x. And then you see it's this line, which indeed fits the data pretty well. You can, if I just delete this for a second, I make my plot again. Instead of first running the lm function, then taking the coefficients in the function ab line, you can just say, well, I'm going to ab line and I give ab line this model here. Because then ab line knows, well, probably you want to fit the line, what we call the regression line. So if I do it like this, and I can maybe give this a color, I give it the color green. And then you see you get the same plot, right? You plot all the results, you make the model, and you draw the line that represents the model. All right, so now before we are actually going to use the linear model, I want to add 3 points to my data set. I call these points A, B, C, and I will specify the X and Y values for A, B, and C. So for example, the observation A has X value equal to 3.4 and Y is equal to 8. If I would add observation A to this plot, you will not see it because the y-axis goes from 2.5 to 5 and the y-coordinate of A is equal to 8, so it would be somewhere here. So I'm going to plot x1, y1 again, but I'm going to make sure that the y and the x-axis are large enough. Here are the observations x1, y1, and now I'm going to add the points A, B, and C, and for that I can use the function points. And then you see that observation A is here, B is here, C is here, and clearly A, B, and C, the red dots, are outliers. They are very different from all the rest of the data. So we already have, and I can draw that here, this is the model when I only use the blue dots. However, my data set with outliers is x1 plus abc. And the same can be done for the y values of your whole data set. So now I can again build a model. I give this model in red, but now I'm not going to use y1, x1, which are only the blue observations. Now I'm going to use y and x, meaning it's all the observations. It's basically your data with the outliers in. And then you find this red line, and you see that with outliers, you get a very different model compared to without outliers, right? However, what I did now is I consider the dataset with and without outliers. However, we can also consider a dataset where I use all the blue observations. I use A, I use B, but I don't use C. Or I can use the blue data with only A, or only B, or only C, right? You can make variations. So let me show a few models there. For example, I can look at the model where I have y1 and the observation A. Okay, so this is a model that uses all the blue observations and this observation A. And then you see that if I include this observation here, then the blue line is not that different from the green line, right? And remember, the green line is the model without the outliers. That's probably the correct model, say. And if I include A, you get something that is close to the green line. And if you compare the green and the blue line, you see that including the observation A will result in a shift of your model. Your line will shift upwards because of this observation A. We can do the same, but now look at the observations, or the observation B. So I take the blue dots and I add the observation B. And then you see that if you only include this observation, then the black line is here. It's very close to the green line. Why is that? Because that observation B, although it's very extreme in both the x and the y direction, right? It's a very large value in the x direction, but also in the y direction. So it's an outlier both for x and for y. However, it follows the trend of your data, right? So it will not distort your linear model a lot, right? It's an extreme observation, but extreme in both directions, and it does not deviate from the trend of the data. And then the last situation is where we add the observation C. And then you see, if I add C, you get this line here, right? This other black line. Then you see that adding C to your blue dots, that has the most impact, right? So the effect of A is a shift from the green to the blue curve. Adding B is nearly the same model than the green curve, so that's okay. It's adding C that has the biggest impact. That will really change the slope and change completely the model. So if you are looking for outliers, this type of outliers, right, is the most important, right? Outliers that are outliers in one direction and will change the slope of your linear model. This outlier is much severe, has a much bigger impact on your model than the outliers A and B.